The broadcast is now starting. All attendees are in listen-only mode.
Thank you for joining this webinar hosted by IMI's Big Data at Heart, live from the University Medical Center in Utrecht. My name is Dwayne Schultes. With the ultimate aim to improve patient outcomes and reduce the societal burden of arterial fibrillation, acute coronary syndrome, and heart failure, the Big Data at Heart Consortium is developing a data-driven research platform of unparalleled scale and resolution. However, with the recent regulatory changes around data privacy, today we are going to discuss the impact of these new rules on the actual harnessing of big data. Thank you for joining us, and today I'm joined by four experts in the field. I'm very pleased to introduce you to Menno Mostert, the Assistant Professor of Health and Data Protection. Hello, Menno.
Hello.
I'm also joined by Natasha Udo-Beauvisage, who's the Global Data Protection Officer at Servier. Hello.
Hello.
Thank you for joining us. We're also joined by Evert Ben Van Veen, who's a Senior Consultant and Partner at MedLaw. Good afternoon.
Hello.
And we're also joined by Shona Kalkman. Shona Kalkman, who's a medical ethicist here at UMC Utrecht, and she'll be joining us for the Q&A. Hello, Shona.
Hello.
So to begin, if you have any questions about what we're doing and you want to send in a question, we will be taking open questions at the end of the webinar. You can use your question bar to submit questions and we will answer them. We should have about 30 minutes. If you're having connection problems, please feel free to switch between your computer audio and the phone. And you should have about 24 different phone lines that you can dial in for free. They are toll free. So with that, I am now going to turn over the floor to Menno, who will present on the legal aspects of the GPRD. Menno, the floor is yours. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Well, in these first 10 to 15 minutes, I will introduce the topic of today, of course, the GDPR and research. In this introduction, the focus is on the research exemptions in the GDPR. Well, I'm going to start off a little bit optimistic, maybe even too optimistic, but we will see. When the GDPR was still a proposal, many feared that it would be a threat to research and it would make most health research impossible. But once the final version was accepted, some thought that the final version would be favorable for research. And, well, when interpreting the GDPR, I guess we need to take this in mind. This is one of the recitals in the GDPR. I just displayed, and what it says that it's not the objective to prohibit research, but to protect or safeguard the use of personal data in research while facilitating such use. So the question we should ask is, why was the GDPR considered favorable? And well, one of the most important reasons are the research exemptions in the GDPR. There are exemptions from some of the consent requirements, the general principles, and some of the individual rights. I will talk about these a little bit more. But before I do this, it's very important to understand how the system of the GDPR works. Because before the flexibility that these research exemptions provide can be invoked, a robust system of data protection measures is required. And these are related to security, to data minimizations, and so forth. Data protection impact assessment may help when deciding on which measures are needed, but there still is a lot of uncertainty here. And more guidance is needed on this topic. This guidance may, for instance, be found in a code of conduct that's still under progress. It's work in progress, but it could be helpful, like many other initiatives in this field. The first exemption I would like to talk about is the research exemption from consent, and this is a much debated issue. Actually, there is such an exemption in the GDPR, but it needs to be implemented in national law. And this means that there's not that much harmonization of the exemptions from consent. And That could be a problem. Another topic is whether broad consent is allowed. Well, broad consent could be legally valid informed consent, especially when we consider Recital 33 of the GDPR, as long as recognized ethical standards are taken into account. And, I'm sorry. When we try to decide on what these ethical standards should be, the SIOMS guidelines and the Declaration of Taipei may provide useful guidance. Well, the next topic of interest is not that much discussed, maybe, but the individual rights in the GDPR. There's not only the mechanism of consent to provide data subjects with control about their data, but there are also there's also a regulation of many individual rights, with again a system of exemptions for scientific research. But when these rights that are displayed right now are likely to render impossible or seriously impair research, it's again possible to have a research exemption. Yet again, some of these research exemptions need to be implemented in national law. So you need to be aware of your national laws on this topic. It's different when it comes to the right to to information and the right to be forgotten. These exemptions are provided by the GDPR itself, and the right to information. There is only an exemption when the data are not obtained from the data subjects. So it comes to secondary use, there usually is an exemption from the obligation to provide information. What is more, there are still some individual rights that need to be obeyed, or where no specific exemptions related to scientific research are present, because there still could be more general exemptions from these rights. And I'm talking about the right to lodge a complaint and the right to erasure, the right to data portability. Well, I guess that especially the right to information is something that that could balance the situation when consent is not obtained. The right to information could even be applicable when it's not required to obtain consent. So there could be situations where you're not required to obtain consent from individuals, but still need to inform them or need to display this information on the general website. Well, my last slide is about the general principles. And these are the, they're called principles in the GDPR. They're not necessarily ethical principles, but they are the framework. And all the rules are based on this framework. We talked about lawfulness. Consent is one of the legal bases to process personal data, but there are many more. We talked about transparency too. But there are more principles, and some of the principles that could be hard to obey to in big data research are storage limitation or purpose limitation. And when it comes to storage limitation, there is an exemption for scientific research or statistical purposes, and data may be stored for longer periods. Another topic of discussion is related to the exemption from the purpose limitation principle. Further processing for scientific research is considered compatible with the initial purpose, but in my opinion, it's always further processing by the controller itself. Well, thank you very much. This was a general introduction, and further discussion will be at the end of all sessions. So questions are welcome.
Thank you very much, Menno. We are now going to move on to the industry perspective on this issue, and we're going to let Natasha Beauvisage present her perspective from the aspects of Servier. So Natasha, the floor is yours. Thank you.
Thank you, Dwayne. So this is my turn to talk about pharmaceutical industry perspective and how this new regulation has some impact on these big data approaches. Just want to say first, as you all know, that there are such huge actual opportunities and expectations from all stakeholders, from big data for the benefit of the patient and the healthcare system. So what we do talk about when we talk about big data, we talk about various sources. We are talking about data collected within the framework of clinical trial with very high quality standard in accordance with the good clinical practices submitted to the ethics committee and approved by the health national authorities and European authorities. We do also talk about real-world data, and there is a very strong expectation on this data, which are real-life data, that are collected within observational studies and via connected and medical devices. What about the use? When this huge number of data sets could be used for internal use within the pharmaceutical company, to generate hypotheses, to better design cohort, to many various use. It could also be used for external purposes that could be part of a partnership with academics, with hospitals, with other pharma company, and the IMI is part of it. And we also may use pool gather these data sets for, within various contexts. It could be requested by health authority, and this is the case with the post-authorization safety studies. Could be also be a drug utilization study, or as it is the case in with big data at heart, with the IMI consortia. So very various situation where we may maybe so useful to to use this data for the benefit of the patient. So what we did expect from the GDPR was harmonization and accountability. So when we talk about secondary use, we really need to go back to the primary use of data, because this is very necessary to come back to the first collection of data and the way, the legal basis, the local applicable law that was in force at the time of the collection has a strong impact on what we are allowed or not to do with this data. So before this new GDPR, the legal basis we used was the consent. And the situation is really different now, because there is a general trend to move forward from the consent to other legal bases like legitimate interest. It has been clearly expressed by some national health authority like the NHS, and also from the Data Protection Authority in France and Czech Republic, where there is a clear position. In other countries, it is not so clear. It depends. There are various practices, and we do not always have a clear position on this legal basis. This is also the case in Germany, for example, where we could have some inconsistency between the GDPR and the clinical trial regulation. So there are situations where the consent is still the legal basis. What about the scope of the collection of the data? When we collect the data, most of the situation, there are an ICF, an informed consent form, that is the context in which data are collected. What we used to do is to have a very narrow and specific drafting scope of the collection, very limited and dedicated to the study, with the use of terms like exclusively, restricted to, limited to, so very narrow purpose. What happened now is that with the GDPR and with the possibility to use the data for further processing, for secondary process, for secondary use, we do now contemplate this possible secondary use from the very first collection. So this is things that we need to mention expressly in the ICF. What about the applicable law? There is a huge, huge change because before the GDPR, what we used to stick to was the location of the sponsor. So when we draft the ICF, we were taking into consideration the law, the applicable law of the sponsor. So we were referring to a single legislation. Of course, we were still taking into consideration more restrictive mandatory requirement of other local legislation, but at least we have really like a single reference that was the applicable law of the sponsor. And now this is different because of the Article 9.4, where there is a freedom to operate for the state for the health and genetic data. That means that we will have to focus on local legislation and see what will be the criteria for the applicable law depending on each local legislation. So we are now facing a real patchwork of legislation, which is really the opposite of the expected harmonization of GDPR. So what now about the secondary use? How can we further process the data in a way that is compliant with data protection legislation? As you can guess, it's very complex now because we really need to take into consideration the local legislation in a strongest way. We have to see whether we should submit. There is a mandatory submission to local ethic committees for this further use, and we are facing many requests from many ethics committee now, and it's not so easy to define whether this is mandatory under the local law or whether it is a request from the ethics committee. In some situation, we may have to ask for an authorization for an express specific authorization from the local data protection authority. And depending also on local legislation, the need of information of the patient may be very different. It could be individual, it could be prior general information, there could be exemption of information, so very, very various situation. What about the impact of the scope of the ICF? We were talking about this narrow consent, so how can we deal with this previous ICF where the purpose was very narrowly described, not from a data perspective, but from more an ethics perspective? Is it something we are allowed to do? Are we allowed to use the data of the people when it was mentioned very clearly that we will not use their data for another purpose than the one, the initial one? And the other point is that once we want to reuse some data sets, we need to go through each ICF and to check what was exactly the scope and if it's possible or not to include patients from this country according to the way the ICF has been drafted at that time. We also may have to take into consideration what is the way it's drafted regarding secondary use, because as explained by Menno, Article 33, Recital 33 of GDPR provide that that patient may accept secondary use for certain areas of research someone and not for others. So we have to take that into consideration. And we have also to take into consideration that in some country where the reuse of data is based on consent, patient may agree to agree for the processing of data for the primary use, which is a study, and may refuse secondary use of their data. And so in that situation, we will have to take into consideration the patient position. And last point is about scientific research. It's not so clear from a pharmaceutical firm perspective how can we rely on this scientific research for secondary use. We would like to make the public authority very aware of the consequences of a very narrow concept of scientific research, because it will really harm the research and this big data approach. There are also possibility of exemption, as explained by Nemo. But once again, we have to go back to local legislation because there are some implementation that are required. And so we have to take into consideration all these different criteria and content to be sure we are allowed to process data for the use. So last slide is to say that there is a real need to, if we want to enhance European research, and if we want a pharmaceutical firm to be part of it, we need to raise awareness of the data protection authority via consultation, via any possible way of the impact of some decision or rules or guidance that are issued and that are a real restriction for this for the processing. We also need to talk and for example, I know we do have a real discussion with the French CNIL and the ethics committee at the moment to see what should be mentioned in the ICF. So this is very important to be part of it and to make the ethics committee aware of the consequences of some requirement for information, for example, of the patient, and the same for member state. So there is a real need of harmonization because we are now in a very complex and difficult situation for pulling and gathering data from various European countries. And regarding more specifically the IME project, we should really stress on the public interest of such project, on the public fundings, European fundings, on the fact that this is a partnership between private and public institution organization. And all of this for the benefit of the scientific community and for sharing knowledge. And so it should really be considered as a scientific research purpose. And we should get some exemption to allow and to enhance this project to go forward.
Thank you very much, Natasha. Just to remind everybody out there listening to us, we have had a few questions come in. We will be answering them in about 10 minutes or so. So please keep the questions coming. You can do so on your question bar. Please submit a question. We will answer them. We've seen a couple come in, and we look forward to answering those questions. So with that, we now move on to Evert Ben, who's going to discuss some other legal aspects of this from the perspective of probably from the project itself, as well as other things as well. So, Evert Ben, the floor is yours. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Natasha raised a lot of questions and also problems in sharing data. We foresaw those problems, so we said that in order to get researchers started, we must sort of have a basic model for data sharing. But there, apart from, so to say, the coming of the GDPR, we were also were confronted with some other aspect of big data at heart, which is problematic in this sense, namely that big data at heart is not one study. It is a platform for performing a lot of studies, different studies. Each study can use different data sources, different data. Data can be shared in various ways. So if you would develop a model, it couldn't be one model because one size does not fit all. So what we did do is state some common principles, sort of building blocks, how to set up your research. And first of all, we didn't want to say top down, oh, you should comply with the GDPR. Yes, of course you must comply with the GDPR. But first of all, give also researchers a sense of pride back in what you are doing. So have a good research idea and then balance methodological requirements with privacy by design and data minimization. And Menno mentioned that already, that is at Article 89.1. Also when you use the research exemptions, you must legitimize why you're using certain data of a certain kind. The GDPR does not forbid to use certain data, but it only says that you must have a good rationale for using those data. And so embed that in a research protocol, because that is the defense against data protection authorities, against ethics committees, but also sort of the legitimation for yourself, that you can look in the mirror, I'm using data, I need to use those data, and that will be done in a responsible way. And also that protocol is sort of a defense why this is research in the proper sense, and namely does not only have a good methodological underpinning, but also that you have a legitimation that you can say that this research might contribute to better health, and so to the public or certain patient groups. Then I'm afraid that something of the GDPR kicks in, and it is a data protection impact assessment. In a data protection impact assessment, you must assess or you must describe the data chain, because research is always a data chain. Data go from a data source with some in-between performations to a researcher. So that's the data chain, and you must assess in that data chain what are the risks of the data subjects, and how can you minimize or mitigate those risks. One data DPIA can cover many similar projects, so that is said when necessary, there might be a DPIA for this project already, but if not, you must make one. And then, of course, that might lead to an adjustment of the research protocol. It might even lead to the fact that perhaps this research cannot be done in this way. Then the second part of the building blocks relates to the data provider. The data source will assess whether the data can be released for research. There is no central Big Data at Heart committee which approves that, because the practice is so varied, we cannot do that. And what, of course, then Natasha mentioned already, there are some new worries, quandaries about whether legacy data can be released for research. The data source should be compliant, and factors which that are taken into account then is whether the original consent allows that. If there is consent, for example, for registry data, there might not be consent. Whether asking new consent is at all feasible, usually it is not. It might not also be necessary. There will be national legislation. Menno mentioned that already, implementing 9.2i of the GDPR, which is about registries actually, but also about post-marketing surveillance without consent, and G, which is then properly for research. And they mentioned that have to be implemented into national law. That might be different for the various countries. Each data source will also have its own governance system, it is assessed whether the data may be released. It might be an access committee, that might be an ethics committee, a privacy committee, and they might also have to ask permission from their national data protection authority. Not all countries have that, but some countries do. And of course, also the type of data which are going to be released will be taken into consideration. And there we come back to that research protocol, which should defend why you need these type of data, and with lesser data, you cannot perform your research. Speaking about data, what we did not do is fall in the trap of the anonymize or consent dichotomy. That is sometimes seen as the answer. Well, consent cannot be the answer, and anonymization cannot be the answer either, because often fully anonymized data without any residual chance of re-identification are not useful for research. There are different systems to navigate around that, like, for example, the data shield, but then you must have a database which allows for using data according to the data shield method. And actually, when there is a very strict informed consent cap on the data, like Natasha told, the original informed consent forms for clinical, the pharmaceutical research, we only use these data, and only our researchers can look at those data, etc., then even anonymization might not be ethically correct, because then the data will still be used for another project. Now, going back is not possible, but there might be a waiver of consent then via either an ethics committee or data protection authority. Because in between consent and anonymization, we hope at least, but we are still vetting that, that national legislation gives much more nuanced options. Now, the other building block then goes again to the researcher, or the type of building blocks. Also, the researcher must get approval for the project, either by the ethics committee. Sometimes the data protection authority must be consulted before you receive data, if there's still personal data. And then we come to what you have to do together as researchers and data sources, namely draft the data transfer agreement, which states under what, for what research purposes the data will be transferred, and the data safety obligations at the site of the receiving researcher. For data transfer agreements can be quite cumbersome, difficult to draft, because everybody wants his own law and litigation mechanisms. But that's the advantage of something like Big Data at Heart, because we already have a consortium agreement where all those issues are already handled. So a data transfer agreement under Big Data at Heart can be rather concise, actually. Then, when you have these data, you must have a data management plan. All funders ask for that, and it's quite logical. What will you do with the data also when the research is ended? And then one very important point, which will come back in also later work in Work Package 7, is you must be transparent. That's both on the side of the data provider, the data source. We're using these data not only for which they were originally collected, but also for further research. And you give examples of that. And also, the research must be transparent. Researcher must be transparent about the project and tell what actually they are doing and why they are doing that. And that's a conditio sine qua non for maintaining public trust. Now, some final remarks. We heard a lot about problems, and but also possible solutions generated by the GDPR. We of Work Package 7 are not to, like I mentioned already, not top-down saying you cannot do this or cannot do that. Actually, we hope to be able to support you, so at least to support research which has which is responsible, in short. And then one thing to one of the possibilities to do that is to hear more detailed examples of what of the type of responsible research which cannot be done at the moment, because you cannot have that by rumors We must have really sort of facts about that, about this was not allowed by this DPIA, while actually, etc., etc. And then we hope to make one or more publications about that to bring the discussion forward. So that's about the basic model. We will work on that model. The next model is now called in our deliverables dynamic model. I think that this model was already quite dynamic by itself, but we will expand it, especially with also ways for citizens and patients participation in the projects. Yeah, and if you want to hear more about Work Package 7, then Shona can tell us later during the questions and answers. Thank you.
Thank you much, Evert, Ben. And we're now going to bring in Shona Kalkman as well. Hello, Shona.
Hi.
Thank you for joining us. And we're going to open up the floor to a general discussion about the project. And again, thank you very much for your participation. Just to get started, I do have one quick question. Under the data, under the GDPR, there's a broad data exemption usage under necessary for the performance of tasks carried out in the public interest. So supposedly you can use data that is performing under a task carried out in the public interest. That's sort of enlarged data reuse exemption. What is the bounds of that exemption from your understanding?
Well, in my opinion, a task carried out in the public interest, there must be a public body which has says, which has mentioned that that is a task. Simply to have public funding is not by itself sufficient. Mm-hmm. So, first of all, this now you're referring to Article 6. We are talking about health data, mm-hmm. So you must also have a basis in Article 9. But Article 6 might be doable for universities, for example, but it cannot be a ground, I'm afraid, in for example, pharmaceutical companies, mm-hmm. because they you cannot call that a task carried out in the public interest.
What if it's an unmet medical need?
Even then, unless you have how do you say that, a public body says you are supposed to do this, that is your task. Then it's more or less by definition carried out in the public interest, because otherwise a public body wouldn't give you that task. But if you do not do this, it's sort of private initiative, then you must, there are other tasks, other grounds as well, from legitimate interest, for example, less than the rights and freedoms of the data subjects way higher. But so task in public interest is a rather narrow exception to the consent principle.
We've had a lot of questions come in, but I also want to just drill in with this with Natasha. From your perspective at Servier, how do you feel about the data reuse requirements as they are right now? Do you find them quite restrictive, more than you'd thought? What's your opinion on that at Servier?
The situation is really complex now, as I expressed, and to be very honest, we were working on a sort of methodology like a guidance, internal guidance for reuse of data, taking into consideration scientific data protection and ethics perspectives, based on a risk-based approach inspired by the data protection impact assessment methodology, and with appropriate safeguards and alternatives to be considered, like anonymization, second pseudonymization, and so on, and involving patients association and ethics in a way or another, just to assess whether from an ethics point of view could be acceptable, this further processing would be acceptable. And I have to say that according to the new guidance issued by the CNIL, we felt a bit stop in our process.
Sure.
And so I think we will have to come back to that internal guidance, because I think you need in your company to have some methodology, as expressed by Hevert. We need to follow a reference principle and then to amend according to local legislation. But at least we need to have the rules. We need to have guidance to
we
follow.
We need to have the clarity.
Yes,
to follow,
exactly.
Right.
It could be a code of conduct
sure.
issued by the European Association, but at the present time we do not have such guidance, such code of conduct. So I think we have to do that in our own company if we want to have this possibility of further use.
Well, I'd love to bring in the ethical point of view.
Yeah, thank you. I mean, the speakers have raised a number of issues about the GDPR. And I think maybe instead of that, the GDPR in itself raises those issues, it points our attention towards the questions that might have always been there, but which are really important now to tackle. And we've heard so many things already. And I think, to me, the central question is, how can we adhere to the GDPR while at the same time making sure that we're not hampering socially valuable research and making sure that that's done in a responsible way? And that's a very big question to answer, but we've heard some aspects already raised, such as what is scientific research? What's that definition? Maybe we should look, do some introspection. What do we mean by that? What does it mean to be research in the public interest? What do we mean by anonymization? And I think we have a lot of work to do, but that it can bring us to a point that we actually improve.
And all of these are being considered in the context of Work Package 7?
Exactly.
Okay. Well, it sounds like you don't have much to do. So. We've got a lot of questions here, and I think we want to start bringing them in. And again, thank you very much. We're going to start running them down now. So we have a question here from Caroline Correas for Menno. Thank you for your presentation, Menno. There you go. That's from Caroline. Could you please clarify whether the research exemption for general principles only applies to purpose limitation and to storage limitation or to all listed general principles? Go ahead. Fire away.
Yes. This question needs a little bit nuanced answer because exemptions from the principles itself, it is correct that only the storage limitation and the purpose limitation principle are exempt. But many of the rules which are based on the other principles could have exemptions by themselves. And those are the rules that I mentioned earlier in my presentation. I like the rule of the right to information is based on the principle of fairness and transparency. So that's my answer. So yes, only the two principles as listed here are exempt for research purposes.
Thank you. Anyone else want to expand on that? We all good? We approve, Menno.
Okay, thank you.
Sure. So we have another question here from Ben McPherson on the subject of legal basis and clinical trials. You've said there is a developing difference in countries between legitimate interest and consent. Will these divergences be resolved? How will the clinical trial regulation affect this? Well, that's a big mouthful. Well, I guess we're going to go to you, Natasha. Why don't you take a jump at that?
Yes, it's handled by data protection, and the point is that we have to make a difference between consent to participate to a study, which is something that is dealt by clinical trial regulation, and from a data protection perspective, the fact that your data will be processed is not based on a consent because there is no choice. Even if you want, if you want to participate to a study and you don't want your data to be processed, it won't be possible for you. So this is not a freely given agreement. So it cannot be considered as a consent from a legal point of view. And this is the reason why the legal basis for processing data within clinical trial cannot be consent. So as I explained, there is a general trend to move forward from consent, so we can expect that. And indeed, I think it will go on. And at the end of the day, I think we will move from consent, and probably legal basis, legitimate interest would be the legal basis for the processing of data in clinical trial.
Sure, Avery, please.
Yes, I agree with that. And then That is the legal basis in Article 6 for the pharmaceutical company. And what would then be the legal basis in Article 9? 9.2J being, so the, and then union law being the CTR, the clinical trial regulation. CTR, yes. Yeah. That would be the legal basis in Article 9 then. Because you must have a legal basis in 6 and in 9.
Yes.
And in 9 it would then be the exemption to consent in the context of research, which we usually think of national implementing legislation, but this would be for a change union law, namely the clinical trial regulation.
And this is being picked up in the clinical trial, the new clinical trial legislation right now?
Yes. Yep.
As you understand it?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Menno, do you have anything to add?
No, nothing to add.
Oh, that's okay. Thank you. So, Ben, thank you very much. And again, if any of you have any questions, please feel free to submit them. We're going down the list now. So we have a question from Christian Oman. Is explicit consent for secondary use of data always required according to the CTR? And this gets to something you said, Menno, where there's not always a need to obtain specific consent. You said this in your presentation. So I'm going to go to you. What are the bounds of that regulation?
Well, explicit consent is not always required, and the CTR is the clinical trials regulation that is mentioned here. But I guess when you go back to the informed consent form that's signed by the participant, it's when you want to reuse data for other purposes than the clinical trial itself, you always need to obtain explicit consent at that point in time for this further use. That's my opinion. When you already know, when you want to reuse the data, you need to obtain consent. You could obtain consent when you would not obtain consent apart from the consent for the clinical trial. It would not be a valid consent for data protection. From a data protection perspective, because the consent would be given freely. So that's a point that Natasha already mentioned before. I don't know if this is the answer to the question, but it's my answer.
So. It's an answer. Yeah, Natasha. Yeah. What's your opinion?
Well, yeah, we did a case study in which we went back to the original consent forms of a number of observational studies and clinical trials, and we found that actually observational studies performed much better in terms of determining or spelling out the rules for secondary use, and clinical trials were quite, well, they just didn't mention data sharing. So to us, that raised the question of what does that mean and how should we deal with it? Does that mean from a legal perspective that you should go back to the patients? So we were quite puzzled by finding that.
Maybe just to add something, I think it's quite complicated to say that this is an explicit consent for secondary use. As far as you agree for something, you don't know what
right.
it will be.
Because it might be open-ended.
It's not specific at
Correct.
All. So you don't know exactly what you agree on. You just agree for further use, but you don't know what it will be. So from my point of view, I mean, from a legal point of view and data protection point of view, it's quite difficult to say that this is a consent because you do not know what you are agreeing or consenting to.
Yes, Ebert Beck.
Yes, thank you. I don't know whether it's allowed, but hello to Christian Oman. I know very well.
You're giving a shout out here.
Yeah.
Okay,
that's okay. Right. But in the recitals of the clinical trial regulation, it says that so for the secondary use, it should be consent. But Natasha is completely right. Is that explicit consent? It can't be explicit consent because it can only then, together with a broad interpretation of recital 33, with broad consent, it can be consent. And otherwise, it does not work because you don't know in advance for what studies you...
Yeah, you don't know what you're going to be studying in advance, right? Exactly.
Yes, so if it is consent, it is broad
consent. It's still
consent.
Explicit, but not specific.
Well, yeah, you're right, quite right.
So you explicitly allow it to be used without an open-ended definition for the type of research. Is that what we're saying?
Yes, exactly. So it should be broad consent then.
Well, ethically, Shona, is that legit?
Sorry, what was that?
No, it can't be specific. in advance.
No, I agree. Yeah.
Okay. But broad consent, and I guess the recital always also goes that way. When you could obtain broad consent for certain areas of scientific research, but it requires something from a perspective of how do you govern the data, what measures do you take to protect the data. So I wouldn't say that it is impossible to obtain legally valid consent at the time of data collection in a clinical trial. It is possible, but you should describe broadly the purposes, and you should, even more important in my opinion, describe how do we handle the data? What do we do to protect your data? So I guess to me, that would be more important too.
Yes. Fine. So thank you, Christian, for your question. And you got a name check from Ebert Ben, which is always great. So we got a couple questions here from Marjorie Seth. How do you handle exploratory discovery style research regarding storage and purpose limitations? It's quite a technical question about use. Who wants to take a crack at that? Anyone? I don't see anyone jumping at the hip here. Who wants to leap on that? Ebert Ben, you want to take a crack?
Oh, yeah. I don't have a definite answer to that, but there is, of course, a tension between that idea of the GDPR that the consent must be specific, that you must have data minimization, etc., etc., on the one hand, and indeed big data and exploratory research. There is a tension between that.
You need, by definition, you need a lot of data.
By definition, and you don't know in advance which data, because that's the whole point of it. And then what Menno just said comes in as well. So you cannot be specific on that, but you can be specific about the data protection, which will, in the smaller sense of the word, like the data safety, you can be specific about that. And Shona and others in Work Package 7 will also work on other mechanisms, like involving patient groups, so that the shift of the vetting process will go from, or the vetting process will go from the individual to more collective, or might go to more collective mechanisms that the research is sound and contributes, etc.
That's great. Shoni, you ever want to contribute to this?
Yeah, and I would like to link it to the next question, if that's possible, or we want to linger
about
a bit more.
Public interest?
Yeah.
So the next question is from Virginie Brofesser, and the question is, who defines what is of public interest? And that was going to go to you with that. So how do we define public interest, Sean?
Thank you. And relating this also to what Everett Ben was saying is that traditionally researchers and funders or public agencies, companies would determine what is public interest. So we have some intuitions about if many people suffer from a certain disease, like burden of disease, or unmet medical needs. But now we're seeing a move towards like thinking differently about that concept, thinking, well, maybe the public also should have a say in what is in the public interest. And a lot of our speakers have talked about justifications. We need extra transparency and more justification about what we are doing, what questions we're tackling, and what data we are using. Who's like, we're using everybody's data is our intention. So here I want to introduce the concept of a social license. So which means a broad an ongoing acceptance from the community that you're supposed to serve. So that's where patient and public involvement comes in. And we're working on that, thinking about the best models to involve patients and public to exactly address this question.
Okay, that's great. Any other comment from the rest of the panel?
Maybe the solution could be general information on a website, on a national or European website, that could provide the needed information to the patient, but would not request to provide an individual information, which is quite impossible in most of the situation. So then we could fulfill the patient expectation and also still compliant maybe with the GDPR or data protection requirement.
Yeah, this is an important strategy that has been mentioned by many people in the field of PPI. It's about transparency, engagement, involvement, and you can't be involved or engaged if you don't have the information to make judgments or co-decide. So public information is one way to go, and will be an important part of it.
Great. Now we have another question here from Maureen Cronin from the project. Hello, Maureen. How will we figure out who we need to get local national approval from in order to do large multinational analysis? So what's going to be the process of doing multi-site, multinational data crunching? What's the process there? Boy, a lot of blank faces. I wish we were on video. Where do we go? Avert Ben, you want to jump at this one?
Yes, I hope that Natasha has
practical
experience, but as I see it, for multinational analyzers come from data sources in various countries, member states, and each member state, each data source must be compliant according to its own national legislation. So it starts with that. And then there will be might be a common platform where the data are analyzed, so that will be a controller in one country, and that controller must also be compliant with their national rules, which are largely generic, by the way, under the GDPR. Restrictions on the use of the data as following from the data source in the various countries will